Other planes that I would think were involved were the stealth fighters and possibly the FB-111 bombers, the longer distance bombers, which are also based in the area.
As everybody in the country must know, this is one of those days on which there truly was a rumor every hour would there be an attack on this, the first day after the deadline for Saddam Hussein to withdraw his troops from Kuwait. And though we appear to be seeing, though we are certainly seeing, I shouldn't say appear to be seeing, all the signs of battle, in Baghdad, as reported to us by Gary Shepard from the western side of the Tigris River in the center of the city virtually, we are not able to confirm anything incoming from Americans. Gary, anything more to report at the moment?
Peter, everything has quieted down now. For a short while ago, as I was saying, there was a great deal of tracer fire going up from the ground. Bursts of red staccato-like nature. Now the sky is clear again. The sounds of the anti-aircraft fire are completely stopped. We have lost regular power here at the hotel. We're using emergency lights here in the ABC News office. And I am looking out and I can still see ground lights on the horizon, but most of the city lights now appear to have been turned off.
In just about 5 minutes, we're going to get a report from the Israeli Defense Forces, as the military is called in Israel. There has been enormous concern there today, of course, that if war begins, Saddam Hussein might live up to his threat and attack Israel first in a concerted effort to divide the coalition of 26 nations, which is presently lined up in the Gulf against him. But there is no sign in Israel whatsoever at the moment that there has been any attack or even any suggested attack against Israel today. The Israelis have gone out of their way to say to us on a number of occasions they'd have about 2 hours to monitor the Iraqi Scud missiles being put into position, because it takes about 2 hours to get a Scud up in order to make the long-range flight that it would be with a limited amount of explosive, or perhaps, sadly to say, worse, from Iraq, from the western portion of Iraq to Israel. But in a couple of minutes, the Israelis are going to have something to say. The Israelis monitor the region very, very carefully, and they are the ones who reported to us a short while ago that Iraqi official radio had gone off the air in the middle of the night. It is about 5 minutes to three in the morning. Bob Zelnick at the Pentagon again. Give us some sense. If this were to begin, either has begun or would begin, what kind of air raid warnings would the Iraqis have, do you know?
Well, that would depend very much on how effectively the U.S. Aircraft and perhaps cruise missiles as well demolished their radar and demolished their air defense system. That's one of the key questions of the early stages of this war, Peter. Under normal circumstances, they would have warnings of several minutes from their radar and their early warning network. But of course, if we're using stealth fighters and those fighters effectively overcome enemy radar, if we're using long-range missiles to put them out, if we're using cruise missiles to otherwise affect key communication systems, they could have very, very little warning.
Okay, just to confirm to people at the moment, we do not know precisely that an American attack has begun from the air on Iraq. We do know what Gary Shepard has been seeing in downtown Baghdad, what appears to be a reaction to something in the air. But there is so much tension in the Middle East at the moment now that the Iraqis may be responding to a diversion mounted by the U.S. military. They may be responding to nothing. One battery may have opened up, which put fear into the other one, or anticipation into the other one, and they've all been spewing anti-aircraft defense up into the air. But Gary has been unable to see, from his reasonably good vantage point there in Baghdad, any incoming aircraft at all, though they thought very early on they would say so. Britt Hume, perhaps if you could at the White House bring us, while we wait for both perhaps the press secretary to come out or the Israelis to say something a moment, bring us up to date on how the president has spent the rest of his day.
Well, the president has been very close to his top national security advisors today. He met with Secretary of State Baker, for example, this morning.
Britt, I apologize.
And then again at lunch.
Let me interrupt you again, because the Associated Press has just moved from central Saudi Arabia which may well be the command headquarters. The following bulletin: war with Iraq began early Thursday as a squadron of U.S. fighter bombers took off from the largest U.S. airbase in central Saudi Arabia. That is the U.S. military making an official announcement in Saudi Arabia, according to the Associated Press, that the attack against Iraq has begun. So what Gary Shepard has been watching from his hotel in Baghdad has not been a mock exercise. Britt, back to you briefly.
Well, I was just going to add, Peter, that one of the things that happened today that was quite unusual was Press Secretary Fitzwater went out of his way during his daily briefing of reporters to read an open letter to journalists. And it was not the first such appeal he had made, which was to get out of Iraq at once. It was, in fact, the third such appeal he has made in the last week, and we were later told that he was prompted to do so by the president, who was alarmed, we're told, by the continuing sight of American journalists reporting from Baghdad on television news reports.
Okay, Britt, thanks. It's 3 o'clock in the morning in the Persian Gulf at the moment. Let's go back to Saudi Arabia, where ABC's Bill Redeker, probably more than anybody else, Bill, can give us some sense that if this is correct and the military has officially announced, as the AP is saying, that the attack has begun, give us an overall sense of what you know to be happening, given the planning, I should say. Stand by for a sec, Bill. We don't have your audio for just a second. If we could open his microphone for a second. Try again, Bill, would you?
We have to be a little bit careful on that confirmation. I'm not sure that we have an official Air Force confirmation yet. All of this does quote an Air Force official in central Riyadh. The aircraft, incidentally, that we're talking about, we have pictures of that were shot about a week ago at that particular airbase in the central part of the country. The ones that took off tonight reportedly were loaded heavily with bombs and underwing fuel tanks, which you can see there under the right wing and left wing. Those, incidentally, are to give it a little bit added range. It's about an hour or so flight north. They are also apparently armed with cannons and air-to-air missiles for self-defense. As Bob pointed out, the F-15E configuration not only is able to do air-to-air combat missions, but also air-to-ground. It can take out enemy targets on the ground as well.
Perhaps we can look at an overall map of the region now, because the U.S. attack would be mounted from a variety of places, from Saudi Arabia, from other countries in the Gulf, from sea as well. Bill, tell us about the stealth and the cruise missiles, the cruise. Gary Shepard in Baghdad. Gary, go ahead.
Okay, the battle has apparently reached here. We have just, you can probably hear in the background, now explosions. I can see at least one or two of them on the western horizon. And listen to this noise coming from the sky.
Go ahead, Gary, keep talking.
The entire sky filled with tracers again, an incredible display. I mean, this looks like fireworks on the 4th of July multiplied by 100. And there are big flashes now in the western sky. I saw at least one obvious bomb blast due west of here. It was a huge red explosion. Quite a few other white flashes right.
Gary Shepard, can you hear us? Gary Shepard, do you hear us in Baghdad? Well, we have lost him for just a second at the very least. Gary Shepard is reporting from the Al Rashid Hotel in downtown Baghdad, where there are more than 100 journalists. And you heard Britt Hume, the White House correspondent, say earlier on that the President's press secretary had urged them to leave. And there was indeed a note of urgency in his note today, in his voice today, as he said those remaining journalists there should decide to come out. Baghdad is, of course, the largest city in Iraq. It's a city of almost 4 million people. And those attacks that Gary is referring to are on the western part of the city, which may be on a number of targets. They may be on targets belonging to the military high command. They may be on the military or civilian airfields, which are in the western part of the city. They may indeed be on a number of the anti-aircraft missile sites. Baghdad has a very significant, if we can look at the map again, please, has a very significant defense around Baghdad. Perhaps we can look at this one over here, gentlemen. Thank you very much. The map up on the upper left-hand side, which gives me the perimeter of Baghdad, will give people a sense, at least in terms of Iraq, if we'll zoom in on that, There are targets all over the country, of course. There are industrial sites. There are almost 60 air bases throughout the country, about 30 of which are bases of considerable use for the Iraqis at the moment, all of which are targets for this massive armada of American, or this armada of American warplanes that everybody expected would take place when the battle began. The policy has been from the beginning to hit the Iraqis as hard as possible from the air at the very beginning, and set the leadership off around Saddam Hussein, completely destabilize it if possible, get Saddam Hussein, if possible, in the view of many military people and political figures in the country as well, but also to suppress all of the Iraqi capability to mount missile attacks on U.S. forces subsequently, or for that matter, to get the Iraqi Air Force off the ground and fighting. Let's go to the State Department, where our national security correspondent, John McCarthy, is standing by. John, just add to this at leisure.
To take the lead on this. If they are hitting targets in Baghdad, it is most likely going to be the military command structure, the communications, maybe even the bridges, as they go after all the sorts of things that can make it more difficult for the command in Baghdad to send out its orders to the front lines down in Kuwait. Tactically, that's probably what they're after.
John, aren't the Iraqis to some extent in a better position because they have hard line, because they're in a defensive position, because they have hardened communications, many of which are under the ground and rather difficult to get at?
Some of their communications is hardened, some of it is microwave, Peter. So what the United States is trying to do is to disrupt the points where the hardened communications and the microwave communications would come together. And there are several of these points around Baghdad, several of these points, in fact, leading down to Kuwait. If they can hit those central communication centers, then they can cut the lines.
Okay, and of course, let's go to Bob Zelnick at the Pentagon and talk a little bit more about this, the electronic warfare, Bob, that may be waged at this very moment by the AWACS and by some of those aircraft which have a capability to blank out a lot of their communications throughout the country.
Yes, the AWACS is certainly one. The Navy has an E-6 based aboard its carriers, and remember, there are six carriers within striking distance of this these targets. There's the F-4 Wild Weasel, which can jam communications. There are any variety of aircraft that can be equipped to do that, Peter.
Okay. The clue for us as to this actually beginning were the F-15s that took off from one of the air bases in central Saudi Arabia and flew off, in the words of one of the flight mechanics there, to make history. This is history in the making, said a Colonel Ray Davis, who was maintaining these F-15s as they took off into night, disappearing in pairs off into the night sky for a flight of almost 600, a little more than 600 miles from central Saudi Arabia to Baghdad. But as has been pointed out on a number of occasions, this is only a minute part of the capacity which the U.S. Air Force has. And throughout this entire run-up to today, it has always been surmised by military and political personnel in the West that the one thing Saddam Hussein and his military never completely appreciated was the full force of the American Air Force, or should I say the full force of American air power from the Air Force and from the Navy, and also from the Army being used against it. In just a minute or so from now, the President's Press Secretary, Marlon Fitzwater, is going to come and make a statement in the White House briefing room, and perhaps he will confirm, just in case you were just joining us, what we already know. Here's Marlon Fitzwater.
Statement by the President of the United States. The liberation of Kuwait has begun. In conjunction with the forces of our coalition partners, the United States has moved under the code name Operation Desert Storm to enforce the mandates of the United Nations Security Council. As of 7 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Operation Desert Storm forces were engaging targets in Kuwait and Iraq. President Bush will address the nation at 9 o'clock p.m. tonight from the Oval Office. I'll try to get you more as soon as we can. Thank you very much.
Well, very sparse details from Marlon Fitzwater, but Desert Shield has become Desert Storm. And he confirmed it started about 7 o'clock Eastern Time, that is to say, American aircraft from the Persian Gulf, from Saudi Arabia, and perhaps from elsewhere in the Persian Gulf itself. Well, not from Turkey, we're told. were over their Iraqi targets, some of them having to make a considerable flight. The attack may also have involved cruise missiles, may well have involved the stealth bomber, the cruise missile, and the stealth bomber, two of America's latest pieces of high technology which have never before been tested in combat. And as Gary Shepard reported a short while ago from the Al Rashid Hotel, there was a tremendous reaction from the Iraqis on the ground. Let's go back to Gary. We can try to go back to Gary Shepard, or we cannot. Okay, so the phone line in Baghdad has, for at least the moment, been severed. Again, we're not altogether sure why that might be the case. It may be the Iraqis, though over the last couple of days, but particularly in the last 24 hours, they have given reporters much more license pretty much to say what they wanted out of there. But because, as John McCarthy pointed out a little earlier, cutting communications to Baghdad to create a sense of isolation in the country for the Iraqi military, particularly for the Iraqi military high command, was a clear intention of the U.S. military high command. Britt Hume is back at the White House. Britt, what can you add?
It occurs to me to suggest that the president's decision, while formally made tonight, was really, in fact, an order given tonight, if not earlier. And it seems to me that based on all that we now know, that the policy that has led to this was one which contemplated the possible use of force from the start, and it really has for some time been up to Saddam Hussein whether it would actually be invoked. But my sense, having watched George Bush through the long months, is that this was a decision that he recognized that he might someday come to, and that he seems not to have flinched from it. And indeed, in watching him today and yesterday and the days leading up to this, it strikes me that he's been remarkably calmer and more serene than one would have imagined if this was not something he'd been thinking about for a long time.
And Britt, though this will come nonetheless as a tremendous surprise to people all over the country and create enormous sadness and anxiety about loved ones in the Gulf. Not, of course, to mention all of the people who may die on both sides of this, we should truly not be surprised that the president acted as quickly after the deadline as he did, should we?
I think not, Peter. And I'm glad you mentioned that, because one of the things that the president was so unyielding about was that this was a real deadline and that the withdrawal had to be unconditional. And I think it struck perhaps many of us from the start that it was a very tall order that he was trying to carry out here. And I think that within the politics of the Middle East, with which you're so familiar, that it might have been possible to negotiate a settlement to this situation if getting Iraq out of Kuwait was really all that was on his mind. But it has never been. My sense about this president is that he has basically staked his presidency and perhaps his place in history on this idea that he and his coalition partners can write a new set of rules for the world in the post-Cold War time, in which aggressors like Saddam Hussein can be repelled and that collective security can be real, and that this was the test case for it, and thus his unyielding stance and his early recognition that force might ultimately have to be used.
Yes, as I think Britt will say in the days ahead, we shall see. The first true indication of alarm has come, perhaps not also ironically, from the oil markets in Houston and New Orleans, which are still open at 7:10 Eastern time, 3 o'clock in the morning Baghdad time, and oil immediately jumped $3 a barrel to $35 a barrel on those two markets. A reminder, as we look back at a map of the Middle East, that the United States gets a little more than 23% of its oil from the region. But that the United States, though taking the lead in all of this, is a member of a coalition because so much of the rest of the world gets so much more of its oil from there. But perhaps it is important on this particular evening, at this particular moment, to try to give you a sense of what is happening. It's going to be very difficult for us to give you a sense of what is happening in a first-hand basis. Perhaps you've all heard in the last several days that when war began, there were going to be very stringent rules imposed on the press by the U.S. military high command. It is also the middle of the night, even if we were able to see anything at the moment. And the only first-hand reporting we've actually had of battle at this moment comes from ABC's Gary Shepard in Baghdad. His line has now been cut, but he reports seeing planes approaching from the west, clearly in search of a number of military political targets in the Baghdad area. And he's very close to the center of downtown and reports no bombs or no missiles falling in the immediate area. But let, as we listen, for example, to Bill Redeker, who is in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia tonight, perhaps with maps and with diagrams, we can give you some sense of the magnitude of this attack that comes at Iraq and at Kuwait, the president referring to this as the liberation of Kuwait, from so many different locations with so much equipment. So, Bill Redeker, just talk at your leisure.
Well, there are a number of air bases in this country, and this was always expected to be the launch point for any air assault. We're very close to one. There's several others scattered around this nation. There are approximately 1,058, that's pretty close to being on target, I believe, combat aircraft that the U.S. itself has deployed here. They're supported by about another 150 support planes that would be carrying fuel and supplies. They have been training, obviously, since about the fourth day they arrived here. The Air Force has always maintained that it would be ready no matter what came, because they are so mobile and they can deploy so quickly. However, several additional aircraft have been brought into the theater within the last week or so. So the air deployment has been completed now for some time, with the addition of those extra planes.
And Bill, the plan has always been to go very, very heavy in the air before committing any American ground forces, right?
That's correct. I mean, that's what initially got General Dugan of the Air Force in trouble for revealing those plans, though others had speculated about it as well. That clearly is where the U.S. has an advantage over the Iraqis. We just had another fighter aircraft take off. I don't think we can see it, but we can see his afterburners behind me.
As you turn around and look off at that airbase to which you are adjacent in eastern Saudi Arabia, just to remind people, we're not going to say where people are in the main, for security purposes, even though it is widely regarded that the U.S. Has total command of the skies. But Bill, as you turn around there, are you seeing a lot of air activity?
Well, no. Maybe we can take a look at what we're seeing. Can we turn left there a little bit beyond the domes here? We're not too far. I can't give the exact location. We're not too far from the air facility. But there is no there's no air activity at this very moment. About an hour ago, an hour and 15 minutes ago, we counted up to 20 fighter aircraft taking off. We can tell they're fighter as opposed to cargo or commercial transport because of the afterglow that's kicked out, because of the size of them and at the speed at which they were traveling. And they were as the military says, deploying rather rapidly, one after another, and heading straight up north.
This doesn't have much to do with combat, but people are always asking me what those blue things are behind you. And as I recall from our visit to you there over Thanksgiving, that is the roof of the swimming pool behind the hotel.
Well, it's a building that's adjacent to the swimming pool. That's correct, Peter.
So nothing very significant to that, but anybody wonders what those blue things all the time, that's what they are. Bill, what sort of a defensive posture was the U.S. in tonight? You filed earlier for World News Tonight on the general goings-on out in the Gulf today, but there was concern there about an Iraqi preemptive strike, wasn't there?
There's been that concern for several days now. We discovered that it was on a heightened state yesterday with the Army. The Patriot anti-aircraft systems here were cranked up to a higher state than they normally are, although they're always on some state of alert. Today we discovered other signs that seemed to indicate that the U.S. was about to launch an attack. Certainly the Navy, which went on, one of its battleships went on DEFCOM, or defensive
condition,
exactly, number two, which is the next stage, which is the second stage, rather, before going to full war alert. We also noticed that troops were being given chemical warfare atropine kits, the antidotes for chemical warfare. They have all been asked to ship back any incidentals. They've been moving forward during the entire, well, I suppose about the last 5 days, but we noticed some of that activity today as well. There, and also some of the fighter aircraft that we also talked about earlier this evening were being armed and loaded. So there were several indications today that seemed to indicate that it was going beyond the normal sort of exercise training that we've become so accustomed to in the last 5 months. It truly seemed like they were getting very ready tonight.
Okay, Bill, obviously, please don't go away. We want to go to Washington now to talk to one of our resident military analysts who knows the Iraqis well and has been paying particular attention today to the configuration of the opening round in the battle. Tony Cordesman is standing by in our Washington bureau. Tony, you also have a map in front of you. Feel free to use it as you want. And give us your own sense, based on your own intelligence, of what you think is going on at the moment.
Peter, I think the most important thing is to understand the scale of this. If they're attacking Baghdad, they're probably attacking the outskirts. Military communications do not go through the center of Baghdad except to the presidential palace. There are numerous underground command sites at least five where Saddam Hussein could be. The key ones are on the outskirts of Baghdad and down near Basra, but there are also underground command sites that they conquered in Kuwait. In addition to that, if
we can I stop you there for a second,
sure.
Tony? Isn't it most unlikely that Saddam Hussein would be in Kuwait tonight?
I think it is very unlikely. If he's anywhere, it would be the outskirts of Baghdad or probably somewhere near Basra, which is the key point in terms of his military control in the south. But there are many other points there, Peter, and as John pointed out earlier, there are many landline communications. What is really vulnerable throughout all of Iraq and throughout Kuwait are major radars used to try to acquire our aircraft. They must have those radars to both acquire them, to use their own fighters, and to use their major surface-to-air missiles. There are approximately 250 surface-to-air missile launchers, major ones, that we may be attacking right now.
Stop on radar for a second for me, because isn't this where we have an advantage, or the U.S. has an advantage with the stealth bomber and the Tomahawk missile? Stand by for a sec, Tony. We're going to go back to Dahran. Bill?
Peter, air raid sirens, or at least air warning sirens, as you point out, went off about 15 seconds ago. Perhaps we can hear those in the background. Are they winding down now? Can you hear that? There they go again.
Bill,
I assume this is purely precautionary. We've seen no air activity other than that's taken off out of here earlier this evening. But
nor do I want
in the background, perhaps you can hear that.
I don't want to be melodramatic about it either, but you are, our audience perhaps doesn't know, but you and I know, you are within range, aren't you, of Iraqi missiles?
That's correct. There are more sirens going off now. We are within range of Scud missiles, though the accuracy of those missiles is not terribly reliable.
Is there a lot of activity elsewhere at the moment? Just talk on about what you see and hear nearby you.
Well, I see people being ordered out of this area right now, Peter, and people are putting on gas masks and being ordered out.
Bill, it's your call, whatever you want to do anytime. Do you want to stay or do you want to go?
I haven't seen do you want to show us what's going on over here, please? I haven't seen any incoming air activity at this point. The sirens have gone up and down. We also see some trucks going out on the highway.
All right, Bill, just to be totally clear about this, at any time you wish to leave us, you leave us. Well, what we lost there was the satellite from the eastern province of Saudi Arabia. And again, this is one of the things that we anticipated might happen. And one of the reasons this might happen, let's go back to Tony Cordesman in Washington and talk about the electronic capability to blank out the whole area. But though quickly, Tony, saying before you begin, I apologize for talking on here, that in this particular instance, it was a power failure which knocked Bill Redeker off the air. So Tony, talk a little bit about that as well, please.
Well, obviously, the power plants are critical to the operations there. There are not that many major power plants, but there are some very central power plants. If those go out, then much of the radar and communications would be degraded, although most of those have separate generators. They do have electric jamming capabilities to suppress those radars. The fact that F-15s seem to have gone into the area indicates we're using active jamming. Our stealth aircraft can't be detected by the radars. With 2,000-pound bombs, they can knock the major radars out. Sea-launched cruise missiles coming from the Gulf can strike at those radars and at the command posts necessary to use them, knocking them out again. At the same time, we can bring in large numbers of aircraft, hitting the surface-to-air missiles and creating corridors, gaps through that allow us to attack other targets. Now, Peter, one thing we have to remember is that there are some 50 to 70 Scud missile launch sites scattered throughout Iraq. Those have to be a critical target to ensure that those can't be used against Saudi Arabia, our forces, or against Israel or any other ally in the coalition.
I was going to make that point earlier about the Scud missiles in the western part of Iraq. They're pointed at Israel. We have been told that the Israeli military is going to make some kind of a statement in the next few minutes. They've delayed it a bit, though. Tony, put your finger on where those Scud missiles are and give us some sense of distance between there and Israel. Isn't it about 250 miles?
Well, it is, and they can reach Israel. But although there are reports of two sites in this area here, there may well be many more sites. It's not quite clear. What is fairly clear that is the missiles that can reach Israel are relatively limited in number and relatively limited in payload. At the same time, what one has to worry about is they're using their Su-24, a very modern Soviet fighter bomber, equipped with chemical bombs and perhaps trying to make one desperate raid to penetrate Israeli airspace at the same time they use those missiles.
Let us go back and use a bit of history as you talk on here, Tony. The last violence we've experienced, of course, is the U.S. raid on Libya. How did American technology perform then on the basis of that? What are you expecting tonight?
Well, American technology did not perform perfectly in Libya. We had a serious problem with the F-111s. They had never been used before in combat, and we only got about 50% of the damage expectancy that we had hoped for. On the other hand, Navy aircraft performed almost perfectly. The key, however, was that that had to be improvised very quickly under the worst possible circumstances in terms of refueling. The forces here have had 4 months in which to test much of this attack plan, and they have validated their concepts with tests in the United States and elsewhere to make sure that these systems will work reasonably well.
I think we're going to have to perhaps talk about one missile system or one weapon system at a time. Talk about the Scud missile now. This is the missile which was, among other things, used by the Iraqis and by the Iranians in the War of the Cities, which they fought during the eight-year-long war that the Iraqis and Iranian field. It's a Soviet weapon. There are two versions, aren't there, Tony? There's an SS-1 Scud and a Scud-B, which is more sophisticated.
That's right. Those are the two Soviet versions. Now, in addition to that, the Iraqis have two other versions. The El Hussein, which was the only system that had the range to reach Tehran in Iran. It wasn't until they developed that system with improved range that they could reply to the Iraqi attacks. Since that time, they've developed another system, which is sometimes called the El Abbas or the El Abed, which has significantly greater payload and may have significantly greater range. That system is particularly dangerous if it has chemical warheads, because it could possibly, at least, carry enough chemical warheads to do serious damage to a city in Saudi Arabia, potentially to Tel Aviv or Jerusalem, or to even targets in Turkey, although that seems an unlikely scenario.
Okay, Tony, stand by for a second. Tony Cordesman, who is one of our leading military analysts in the country, will be with us throughout the evening. He will be with us for the duration. I want to go to Capitol Hill in just a minute to talk to ABC's Jim Wooten, but before we do, I'd like to play a little bit of the tape from Gary Shepard in the Al Rashid Hotel in Baghdad, which was the very first hint any of us had tonight that anything was going on. We were talking to him on the phone at the time.
Peter, I am looking directly west from our hotel now, and throughout the entire sky there are flashes of light. It appears to be some sort of anti-aircraft fire, a couple of flashes on the horizon now. Something is definitely underway here. Something is going on. The whole sky lit up with these flashes continually.
Is it far in the distance, Gary?
Occurring, and now we can see an obvious tracers in the sky. Planes now coming toward this hotel, and flashes, the sound of flak and flares. Obviously, an attack is underway of some sort. It appears that there is tracer fire coming up from the ground, and an incredible panorama of flashes continuing as I speak.
How close is it to the city where you are, Gary?
We now see an entire stream of red tracer fire. And now sirens, air raid sirens, are beginning the sound over Baghdad. The lights of the city itself continue to burn on the ground. Street lights, house lights. And as this occurs, the flashes continue throughout the sky. There's obviously an air raid underway right now. The air raid sirens continuing. We see more tracer fire going up, huge flashes in the sky. throughout the sky.
Gary?
Yes, Peter.
Gary Shepard talking to us a while ago. The very first hint we had at all that what the president calls the liberation of Kuwait had actually begun. Those first American aircraft took off. I had the time here just a moment ago, but I've lost it. I'll come back to it. Flew to Baghdad, where it is now 3:27 in the morning and the battle fully underway. One of the early concerns, Tony Cordesman made a reference there to the concern, as everybody's expressed it over the last several weeks and months, that there might be an attack on Israel. ABC's Dean Reynolds is standing by in Jerusalem. Dean, can you give us any hint from there of what is going on?
Peter, it's quiet here, I would say almost still this evening. We are awaiting an announcement from the Army. So far, there have been no air raid sirens. The radio has, in fact, been repeating some of the broadcasts made by Gary Shepard from Baghdad. The sense here is one of very low profile. They're maintaining that low profile to stay out of this conflict. As we look out on the Jerusalem skyline, we see nothing but the normal lights of the evening. And from our other ABC personnel around the country, also nothing out of the ordinary.
You're able to monitor radio from there fairly effectively throughout the Middle East. Are you picking up anything from the Arab world?
Not so far, Peter. We have, as you know, reported that Radio Baghdad was being jammed. Was knocked off the air, exactly. But we have not heard anything specific from the other parts of the Arab world, although we are monitoring it.
Okay, thanks very much, Dean Reynolds in Jerusalem. Please stand by. I finally found those figures. The first F-15 took off from central Saudi Arabia at 4:50 p.m. New York time, which was 50 minutes past midnight in the Gulf. And they would have taken an hour to get from there to Baghdad. And those are the targets that we are specifically aware they have been hitting, the airport and the missile installations around Baghdad, because we heard that from Gary Shepard. We have been hearing from Tony Cordesman, one of our military analysts, that they are assumedly hitting all over the country. Also joining us from Boston is General Bernard Traynor, who's also our going to be a resident military analyst for us for the duration of this war. General Traynor, what are your first thoughts?
Well, Peter, I think this is probably the start of a massive air campaign. I would suspect there's probably between 400 to 600 aircraft in this initial wave. The very interesting thing was that the air raid sirens in Baghdad did not sound until after your reporter on the scene gave an indication of anti-aircraft fire. And I think this indicates that the first wave or the first strikes into Baghdad were probably by the stealth aircraft, and they didn't pick them up until the explosions began. Now, with regard to targets, particularly in view of the fact that they lost their communications out of Baghdad, I would suspect one of the principal targets that the stealth was after was the electrical grid, the communications grid, which allowed Baghdad to communicate and produce electricity. So at this point, I think the game plan to electronically cripple the Iraqis is well underway.
Just to remind our audience, or to tell our audience, in case you haven't seen General Traynor with us before, that he's had as much experience as any senior American military officer with the Iraqis. You spent about 6-7 months with the Iraqi military, didn't you?
No, it was about 2 months.
I beg your pardon, 2 months with them. But in listening to you earlier today, we talked a little bit about their preparedness. If the air raid sirens didn't work, as you say, they didn't, and we didn't hear them for quite some time. Are you surprised?
Nope, not at all. The stealth aircraft are designed to do exactly that. They would be going after targets such as command and control and electrical grids to dominate the communications network of the Iraqis. I wouldn't figure that the stealth aircraft would be going after anti-aircraft missiles. The other aircraft, which will follow and surely are in the air at this point, will be going after that sort of target.
Give us a sense, General Traynor, of how much is in the air at the moment and where you think it may be just in terms of flying time.
Well, I'm just assuming that we can generate a rate of about 2,000 attacks in a 24-hour period, given the number of aircraft that we have over there. And if we've just launched this sort of thing, just a ballpark estimate would be that we'd be something in the vicinity from, as I've indicated, probably 400 to 600 aircraft striking targets not only in Iraq but also in Kuwait. And these would be, I would assume, primarily at targets which would allow the Iraqis to control their anti-air defenses, things like their radars, things like their communications. And the preliminary indications seem to bear that out.
Okay, General Trainor, stand by for a second. We're going to go to overseas now to London, where ABC's chief foreign correspondent, Pierre Salinger, is standing by. We have indeed lost communications not only from Baghdad at the moment, but also from eastern Saudi Arabia. In the case of Saudi Arabia, we're not sure whether that's a result of something more than a power failure. As Bill Redeker was standing there, out not very far from the ABC News offices, the air raid sirens went. The ABC News office is quite close to an operating military airfield. So we'll try to keep you up to date as to what may be happening in that particular location of eastern Saudi Arabia. But from now, we are, as we always suspected we would be, going to be listening to this from the fringes and trying to analyze it from the fringes, in some cases at great distance, for some considerable period of time. Pierre Salinger in London.
Yeah, well, Peter, you're very accurate because now we're being cut off from the real information coming out of that area, although we have heard already that there have been three waves of U.S. air attacks by F-15 aircraft, among other things. And those attacks have been going against not only Baghdad, but also against certain Iraqi positions in Kuwait. Other than that, we have heard that there is, of course, an alert inside Saudi Arabia. Sirens in Riyadh, in Dhahran, people going into bomb shelters, and that is the situation as we know now. We don't have any more details.
Okay, Pierre, thanks very much. Anything you can pick up from elsewhere in the Middle East, to Syria in particular, and Egypt. Syria and Egypt, both members of the international coalition, and though there was never any thought that Syria and Egypt would be involved in the first wave of attack against Iraq and against occupied Kuwait. In some cases, Arab forces and certainly French forces and British forces on the ground are farther forward, closer to the Iraqi positions, than are many Americans. Let's go to Washington again. ABC's Jim Wooten is on Capitol Hill. Jim.
Well, Peter, speaking of the periphery of this whole thing, I think I am on one of the peripheries of this story, but I can tell you that the leadership of the Congress on the House side, Speaker Foley and Minority Leader Michael, and on the Senate side, Minority Leader Dole and the Senate Majority Leader Mitchell, are all watching now on television, as I assume most of America is. One of the interesting things to note was this afternoon, in this age of cellular phones and electronic marvels, that when the president tried to reach the Speaker of the House, Mr. Foley, to tell him that this was about to happen, he couldn't be reached. He was at Brooks Brothers buying shirts. It's also interesting to note that on the floor of the House today, Representative Henry Gonzalez, who is something of a figure in the House by being chairman of the House Banking Committee, introduced a resolution with five articles of impeachment against President Bush. I can tell you that, like most of the stories that will come from Congress in the next few days, that will soon be forgotten.
Jim, you are, I think, saying that now that it has begun, the Congress is going to simply line up lock solid behind the president?
Oh, I think that's absolutely true. There will be, I think, in private conversations, remonstrations against the president by those who voted against the resolution authorizing him to do what he has done this evening. But in public, you will hear nothing but support.
And it will, of course, also be support for American forces of the Gulf, which for many politicians will be infinitely more important than support for the president.
Exactly.
Okay. What am I recall, Jim, that a couple of congressmen have sons in the Persian Gulf, just two?
As far as I know, Peter, there are two. There is a congressman from California, I believe, who has a Marine who is there.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jim. Please don't go away, or at least continue to work the beat, because we'll want to come back to you. Most people, I think, in the country know at this point now that there is a considerable portion of the American business and political elite which has no direct involvement in the Gulf, like so much of America in the Midwest, particularly in the South, has. I'm recalling that the other night when we were doing a report about this, we phoned around to 20 major American corporations quite haphazardly, quite at random, and found not one CEO had a son or a daughter in the Gulf. And let us now move on to the military campaign. Dean Reynolds in Jerusalem. Dean.
The Army has just put out an announcement to the Israeli public. It is that
due to the attack, the apparent attack of the American forces in the Gulf, citizens of Israel are asked to open their gas mask kits and to stay at home and to keep the kits with them at all times. They are asking...
Yeah, that's an electrical problem everywhere. So we lose Dean Reynolds in Jerusalem. There he is back again. Dean, continue.
I was saying, Peter, that they are asking essential workers to report for their jobs this morning to continue to maintain a level of service, to also carry their gas mask. But it is not a state of emergency. They have not declared a state of emergency. This is typical...
Really, a precaution. And there has, as I said earlier, there have been no air raid siren, and the place is still. It is quiet. They are doing what any country that has been named as a target by Saddam Hussein would do once the hostilities have erupted, as they did this evening.
Okay. This is also true, of course, about eastern Saudi Arabia. Let's take a look at the big Middle East map again and try to give you some sense of the distances there tonight. The night sky, it's the middle of the night, absolutely the middle of the night in the Middle East. 3:30 in the morning in Baghdad, and 3:30 in the morning, I think, in Israel as well. I don't there may be an hour time change, but I'm not sure there is. But everywhere it is certainly dark. There is no serious first light yet. The sky cleared up earlier this evening. There was a pretty heavy fog, which American military personnel said at one point the Air Force would have no trouble flying through. But if we can stop right there on the map and then come back out again, you'll get some sense of the military assets which are already involved in this war and some of the distances. From Tel Aviv to the Iraqi border, from about where Dean Reynolds was speaking to where some of the first Iraqi missiles might indeed be deployed, is only about 250 miles. And if you look there at the Persian Gulf, where there were two American carriers tonight, the Ranger and the Midway, I think, are the two American characters in the Gulf on the right there now. Up from there, up to Baghdad and various targets, is about 300, 400 miles in some cases to targets in Iraq and in Kuwait. From Kuwait City all the way down, right down to the Strait of Hormuz, is about 500 miles. So all of those aircraft carriers, both on the left in the Red Sea, you can see four American carriers there. That's the configuration as of a little earlier today. Four American carriers in the Red Sea on the western side of Saudi Arabia, and two in the Persian Gulf, where Iraq and Iran and Saudi Arabia and all the other Emirates and Kuwait come together. There are a lot of attack aircraft on board those particular carriers. And in fact, let's go to our Pentagon correspondent, Bob Zelnick, who's standing by, because he can bring us up to date a little, I think, on the capability of the attack aircraft from on board those aircraft carriers. Bob, normally, as I recall, only about 25% of an aircraft carrier's airplanes are used for attacking, but there are many more available at the moment, right?
Yes, the A-6 is certainly one of the principal ones there, Peter, and altogether there are about 425 combat aircraft available to be used in this attack. We expect to have more details of this and specific details just after the President speaks, Peter, because Secretary Cheney and General Colin Powell, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, are going to conduct their own briefing at that time. I might add that one of the principal worries of the United States military in the field and at the Pentagon has failed to materialize, and that is the fear that Iraq would somehow succeed in hitting Israel before the U.S. and its allies joined the fight against Iraq. That could have cost the U.S. its Arab support. They were very, very worried about that. It apparently has not happened.
Not happened as of now, anyway, Bob Zelnick. Thank you very much. And as best we can tell, the attack on Iraq began maybe 45 minutes ago. It's now 7:41 Eastern Time, 3:41 in the morning in Baghdad. The President is going to talk in about an hour and 20 minutes from now. Britt Hume at the White House.
Now told that that speech is expected to last about 10 to 12 minutes, and that the President has worked his way through something like four drafts of it. I've heard from other people here that the speechwriters have been on almost 24-hour duty for days and are absolutely bleary-eyed with exhaustion. And in part, that's because they've had to work on differing drafts without any real knowledge of exactly what's going to happen. The president is said, however, to have been at work on these various drafts for several days, which goes back to the point you and I were talking about earlier, that he has obviously been contemplating this for some time. He's between 6 and 7 is when he made his calls to the leaders, we're told, and he did it from the small study adjacent to the Oval Office, and he had Vice President Quayle, National Security Advisor Scowcroft, and his Chief of Staff, Governor Sununu, with him when he made those calls. He's also called some foreign leaders, a list of those to come later.
Okay, Britt, thanks very much. A number of people, obviously, politicians and statespersons of all persuasion are going to want to talk within the next 24 hours. The Kuwaiti ambassador to the United Nations has made a statement in which he says the military action fulfills the wish of the international community to liberate Kuwait from the Iraqi aggression, and he wishes victory for this operation. It used to be called Desert Shield when it was a standing operation defending Saudi Arabia against any further Iraqi aggression and perhaps waiting for offensive action. Now that it is a war, the president is calling it Operation Desert Storm. The Secretary General of the United Nations, who made that last ill-fated attempt to try to talk Saddam Hussein into a political settlement, has also expected to make some statements a little later this evening. But you will recall, if you are watching or listening to the reporting over the last several days, he came back extremely depressed. In the words of ABC's David Ensor, who flew back from Europe with him, Saddam Hussein seemed much more concerned about offering tea and coffee to the Secretary General than engaging in any kind of a dialogue at all with the Secretary General. And there are people, by the way, those who know Saddam Hussein better than most, not that many people know him very well at all, who believe that one of the things in his mind is to try to get this battle started, to say to the Iraqi people and his other supporters in the Middle East and elsewhere in the developing world that he has stood up to the American imperialists, and then perhaps try to sue for some kind of peace before his country is totally obliterated. That is, if you believe that the American military and the other 25 nations aligned against him in the Gulf are capable of doing the damage which so many military planners have said they are capable of doing. Britt Hume at the White House again. Britt.
Peter, just one brief further thing. We've been trying to get some sense of the nature of this attack, whether this is a preliminary attack with limited goals or whether this is all out. And spokesman Fitzwater simply would tell us that the attack will be and is being swift and massive. Swift and massive, his words.
Okay, Britt Hume, thank you very much. We said earlier that the price of oil on the Houston and New Orleans markets, which were still open about a half hour ago, had jumped $3 a barrel immediately on the news that America had gone to war against Iraq. They're now at $35 a barrel. The Tokyo stock market, which is perhaps as sensitive to political and military happenings as any in the world, has fallen by almost 1.5%. It is down 300 points at the moment. War has begun between the United States and Iraq. I say the United States and Iraq because we are not yet sure that other members of the coalition, namely the British and the French, who have an air capability, have engaged in this initial assault against Kuwait and against Iraq. But that is news to come. We will go away and try to pull in some more information over the next 3 minutes. So we will be back after this and a word from your local ABC station. We hope you'll stay with us.
Now you can ask Angela Lansbury about Bufferin.
Angela, for a tough headache, is Bufferin really strong aspirin?
Oh my, yes. I've learned extra strength Bufferin has the strongest dose of aspirin you can buy, 1,000 milligrams.
Miss Lansbury, how can Bufferin be so strong if it has buffers?
I wondered myself, till I heard that the buffers don't weaken it. They just help prevent aspirin stomach upset. I depend on Bufferin.
Shouldn't you discover the strength of Bufferin?
Up to here with antacid taste.
Then get great flavor up to here with extra strength Maalox Plus Cherry Cream. Up to here with mint cream. Up to here with lemon Swiss cream.
Maalox, you're the best.
It's the strongest, best tasting antacid.
Now the 6 o'clock report. Washington.
Yeah.
We can't work unless you take something for that cold.
Right, that.
Not that kind. Take Contact.
Here all is.
Contact is different.
With 600 tiny Tide pills, Contact is different.
Contact lasts for 12 hours, up to 3 times longer than ordinary cold medicine, so there's a whole day's work in every contact. And now, the 11 o'clock report.
There's a whole day's work in every contact.
Right now, we're all concerned with the outbreak of war in the Gulf. Monitoring the world 24 hours a day. Stay with the experience of ABC News.
The question is, how do you get the sofa you want in the style and fabric you want and get it in 35 days? The answer, Choice Seating Gallery. And save now during our clearance sale. First, make your choice from over 400 styles and choose from over 1,000 fabrics. Then put the fabric of your choice on the style of your choice and get it as a sofa and love seat, or a sleeper and chair, or even a sectional and get delivery in just 35 days. Save 25 to 50% during Choice Seating's clearance sale.
Super Pretzels. Microwavable soft pretzels from your grocer's freezer. No fat, no cholesterol. Warm, soft, delicious. They really hit the spot. Usually. Super Pretzels. Soft pretzels. There's nothing hard about them. Super Pretzels. Microwavable soft pretzels from your grocer's freezer. No fat, no cholesterol. Warm, soft, delicious. You can't beat them. Super Pretzels. Soft pretzels. There's nothing hard about them.
When you're in the market for freshness, when you're in the market for savings,
take advantage of Thriftway's half price sale and save on Tropicana Pure Premium Orange Juice. Half price at just $1.74 a half gallon. Maine potatoes, half price at 98 cents for a 5-pound bag. Half price off assorted Stauffer's lean cuisine entrees and country fresh chicken leg quarters, only 39 cents a pound, sold in economy packs.
When you're in the market for value, you're in Thriftway.
Delaware Valley's watching Channel 6.
News coverage of the Gulf War continues. Once again from New York, Peter Jennings.
I want to bring you up to date as best we can, and it is difficult, and it is going to be difficult. But what we know is this. About 50 minutes ago, American aircraft and perhaps American missiles, perhaps including the Tomahawk cruise missiles fired from the Persian Gulf, suddenly descended on Iraq and occupied Kuwait out of a very dark but very clear night sky. The war in the Persian Gulf has begun. What was known for so long as Operation Desert Shield is now called by President Bush Desert Cloud, who made a statement from the White House a short while ago simply saying the liberation of Kuwait has begun. We expect to hear from the president in person to address the nation in about an hour and 10 minutes from now. We have no sense whatsoever of an Iraqi response or an Iraqi retaliation other than in some very early reporting, the earliest reporting from ABC's Gary Shepherd, that there was a fierce defense made by anti-aircraft artillery on the western outskirts of Baghdad. So as we have long suspected, the communications and command installations on the western edge of Baghdad were at the very least targets, including the missile batteries on the outskirts of the city and the international and military airfields there. There was, of course, very early concern that Saddam Hussein, who today assumed complete command of all the Iraqi military, we're not sure altogether what that means, but it was announced in Baghdad today, threatened to attack Israel the moment the war began. But there is no indication, according to ABC's Dean Reynolds, from Israel that there has been any move against Israel whatsoever. In eastern Saudi Arabia, where ABC's news offices are located, we were talking to ABC's Bill Redeker when the air raid sirens went off there, and all of the ABC News personnel and a number of the other civilian personnel, perhaps all of them, as best we can tell, adjacent to an airbase in eastern Saudi Arabia, have been told to go to air raid shelters, at least for the moment. Sirens have gone off throughout Saudi Arabia in Riyadh, the capital. We can take perhaps a look at a map there. And in Dhahran, we have known of the air raid sirens going off, but do not have a full sense as to how the civilian population is responding. On the phone from Riyadh in Saudi Arabia, which is the location of the U.S. military's high command, is ABC's Barry Dunsmore. Barry, go ahead.
Well, Peter, we are not hearing any information whatsoever from the high command at the moment, although, as you pointed out, this is the spot for the Joint Information Bureau. So far, they have referred us to the White House and the Pentagon. But at some point, perhaps we will be able to get additional information. As far as the situation in Riyadh is concerned, about 20 minutes ago or so, we did have air raid sirens going. And as we had been told that we were well outside the range of aircraft, if air raid sirens were to go here, it was the possibility of a missile attack. and there is some possibility that those missiles could be carrying chemical weapons. Therefore, most of the people with ABC News and the other networks who are here in Riyadh have suited up into their anti-chemical and nuclear and biological warfare suits with their gas masks handy. Those sirens that alerted us to the possibility of some kind of attack have stopped, and so at this point we are not really certain what to expect next.
Barry, what happens at the moment in terms of command? Does General Norman Schwarzkopf, the supreme American commander in the region, take control, or do the Saudis have control?
Well, as you well know, this has been one of the touchy issues throughout this entire 5 month running up period. I think it's reasonable to assume that General Schwarzkopf is running the show, and I'm sure he is doing everything he can to keep the Saudis in the picture and make them part of it. But clearly, with the more than 400,000 U.S. troops here and the fact that the United States would be in the running of the attack, as it were, General Schwarzkopf can be assumed to be in command.
Barry, do you have any sense whatsoever of how the Saudi Arabian civilian population has responded to the beginning of war? Can you look out your window and see anything? It's what, almost 4 o'clock in the morning?
Well, it's almost 4 o'clock in the morning, and we don't see very much from the windows here, Peter. There are some people who are planning to venture out and take a look. I can tell you that today there has been, a fairly high level of anxiety, but certainly I don't think anything approaching panic. They are quite stoic about it in many cases, saying, you know, if God wills it, they will be fine, and if God doesn't will it, they won't. I think that basically the Saudis particularly for a long, long time have assumed that this day would never happen, that somehow they would be rescued deus ex machina and everything would be fine. So it's perhaps a little premature to predict what their reaction is going to be now that war has actually begun.
Okay, thanks very much, Barry. As you point out, the Saudis have been fairly calm throughout this whole thing, saying the Americans will protect us. So as Barry points out, hearing the air raid sirens in Riyadh, which is about, looking at my chart, about 616 miles to Baghdad, but less to Kuwait, about 332 miles to Kuwait. It's a very long range, as Barry Dunsmore points out, and as one of our military analysts, Tony Cordesman, has pointed out, the Soviet or even the Iraqi refined Scud missile, one of their heavy range missiles, is an inaccurate weapon over such considerable distance and, of course, has a very reduced payload. That is to say, how much it can carry, but when it is carrying chemical weapons, which, of course, is everybody's great fear in the region, it needn't be very heavy at all. Ironically, the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Admiral William Crowe, who knows the region so well, was saying to us some time ago, the very obvious, it is not a dangerous weapon unless, of course, it lands anywhere adjacent to you. And then anything, no matter how heavy or how light its payload is obvious. Back to the White House and Britt Hume.
Surfacing here, Peter, about the decision to do this, how it was made and when it was made. We're told now that the president had decided on this date. And it was set by virtue of the military's priorities, according to military priorities, several days ago, before it was clear whether there'd be some last-minute move by Iraq to comply with the deadline, and that indeed the statement that was read here tonight in the president's name was written yesterday. The president is said to have been watching news reports on the air tonight and to have seen these first reports, which may indeed, and I believe were the ones that that we broadcast, and to have remarked to those sitting with him in the little study there that the air raid over Baghdad was happening just according to the schedule, and that that was the first word he had heard in the sense of news reports was this evening as he was sitting in the room where he had called the congressional leaders with his top aides.
Okay, Britt, thanks very much. We'll be coming back to you. It is now called Operation Desert Storm. It is an American operation at the outset, but ABC's Pierre Salinger is standing by in London. Pierre, my
yes.
Apologies. Do we think the British have joined this initial phase of the operation?
Yes, we now have confirmation, Peter, from the British Ministry of Defense that the British are involved, that Tornado aircraft are involved in the air raids on Iraq and on Iraqi positions in Kuwait.
Yes, I am. The air raid siren here is going off again. General alarm.
Okay, that's an interruption from Barry Dunsmore, who is in Riyadh, who says the air raid siren is going off again. Barry, continue.
No, I just said that the air raid sirens here in Riyadh have begun to go off again. And as I indicated earlier, the instructions we have had are to get into our suits.
Which you sound like you're doing at the moment, are you?
In fact, I've got it on. And I've got my mask handy.
If you feel like putting it on, Barry, it's more important that you feel that you put that on if you want to than that you talk to us. So it's your call, as always. Perhaps we'll go away from Barry Dunsmore for just a moment now and let him have a couple of moments to consider his own situation, as people throughout the Persian Gulf are considering their situation tonight. Want to talk a little bit about the difficulty of mounting a night operation such as this. There are so many components to what we are talking about tonight, and there are so many families all over America and families all over Europe and the Arab world who have people in the Gulf, whether they're members of the armed forces, or in the case of many Arab Americans, they are civilians within the line of fire tonight, for whom this is quite an horrendous night. And there is simply no way to minimize the sense of catastrophe that people in this country and elsewhere feel now that Operation Desert Storm has actually begun. We take it as our role at this moment to keep you up to date with all of the political and social and military components of the developing battle. There are in the night sky tonight in various parts of the Persian Gulf American aircraft. We have a brief report now from ABC's Dennis Trout on just how difficult it is for American pilots to fight under these conditions, even unopposed.
On a clear day, anyone can see forever in the desert. But on a clear night...
Oh, we own the night. We own the night.
On a clear night, special nighttime vision equipment means that U.S. forces can see forever then, too, or almost forever. U.S. forces are expected to have an enormous advantage in combat with Iraq. That's because new technology allows Americans to do much of the fighting at night, when they can see, and presumably, the Iraqis cannot.
We consider the night warfare capabilities, both in the air and on the ground, of our forces to be a tremendous advantage militarily.
One system used in the Gulf is called Lantern. Seen here in tests in Arizona, Lantern uses a combination of infrared and radar technology that turns night into day. The result is plain to see. Pilots can fly extremely close to the ground without crashing, then find and destroy enemy targets with startling accuracy.
It is the most advanced, the best, in the tactical fighter business. That I've ever experienced.
American commanders are eager for much of the fighting to happen at night, when U.S. aircraft would be far less vulnerable to handheld Iraqi missiles. When the U.S. bombed Libya in 1986 in response to terrorist attacks, the raid came at night. So did the invasion of Panama in 1989, when night flying helicopters attacked military facilities and transported special operations forces. U.S. helicopters can fly at night when pilots wear special night vision goggles, which take existing light, such as from the moon or stars, and amplify it several thousand times.
But using all this high-tech equipment can be something of a high-wire act. Experts caution that what looks so promising in training often can fail in a real war. Dennis Trout, ABC News, the Pentagon.
Dennis Trout on one of the aspects of tonight's fighting. We heard earlier from ABC's Jim Wooten and from Britt Hume that the President Bush had, shortly before 7 o'clock this evening, in fact, a little bit before that, had spoken to the political leadership up on the Hill, and the Democratic majority, the Democratic leader in the Senate, Senator Byrd, had this to say after he'd spoken to the President. Okay. Well, we have it somewhere, and as I'm sure you'd expect in the early stages of this coverage, there is a lot bound to go wrong technically. It happens almost all the time. Before we go back to the Middle East, and we're trying to reestablish contact with Gary Shepard at the Al Rashid Hotel in Baghdad, where it's a little after 4 o'clock in the morning, let me go to Tony Cordesman, one of our two military analysts, and pick up a little bit, if I may, Tony Cordesman, there where Dennis Trout left off on the difficulties of flying at night. It is widely regarded as having been a big plus and an advantage for Americans, but it always looks easier on videotape than it really is, doesn't it?
It always does, Peter, but I think we have to stress that at this point it is not the attack aircraft that have to fly low to the ground which are going to be doing the attack, but aircraft designed for the night that are flown constantly at night. The F-117 is a night aircraft. That's its mission. The F-15E is one of the most sophisticated night attack aircraft in the world, and that has been tested now for several years and works superbly. In addition to that, many of the carrier aircraft have excellent night warfare capability, particularly the A-6s. So we are dealing with aircraft flying at higher altitudes against fixed targets, where these targets are well known in general from photo reconnaissance. And they should be able to conduct this phase of the night war with great effectiveness.
Now, there's a lot of talk about all sorts of people having night glasses that they never had before, a new development. We've seen them used on the ground as well. Aren't they also somewhat disorienting for the people who are wearing them, even if they've had some training?
Well, they can be somewhat disorienting, but in fact, the overall performance using those goggles with helicopters has been relatively good. The Marines use them in their AV-8s, the night units that are equipped in that aircraft. It's a V-stall fighter, one that can take straight up. They too have done very well. At this point in time, however, there won't be aircraft using those night vision devices. This will be a matter of radar and long-range infrared like the Lantern system.
I want to bring General Traynor in here for a second, because there's also been some talk, General Traynor. In fact, you were the one who really emphasized it. Are you there in Boston?
I am indeed.
I can have a look at you. Thank you. Always makes me feel better. You were the one who made the point that because the air raid warnings seem to be lagging behind an attack in Baghdad, that perhaps what was being used was the stealth bomber. Yes. This is a new piece of American technology. It was used in Panama for only the first time. Do you get a sense of what it would have been up again in terms of its own technology?
Well, in Panama, one of their problems was that they didn't have the digitized maps for the target area, because it wasn't anticipated using the stealth there. But clearly the...
What is a digitized map?
A map that is really turned into a computer so that the aircraft automatically follows the map coordinates that are translated from a geographic designation into electronic impulse. And they didn't have that for Panama, but they do have it, as I understand it, for the Middle East. So therefore, the pilot really just turns it over to this computer, who follows the map to the specific target and delivers the ordnance all automatically. So if everything is working perfectly, they put it right on target, and the recipient of the attack never knows what hit him.
And the stealth technology for the uninitiated is a combination of everything from paint to the materials in the aircraft, which is designed not to reflect a radar beam coming at you.
And the configuration of the aircraft.
And the configuration as well. Mm-hmm. So from a military point of view, a purely calculating military point of view, you and others will want to know tonight precisely how the stealth performed at night.
That's correct. And I'd be surprised if the stealth wasn't in on the initial attack. That's what it's designed for. I think it was very interesting that Pierre reported that the British had joined, and I think on the basis of that, I think we can count that the French were involved in it, and I would imagine the Saudis are involved in the operations, perhaps down in the Kuwait area. One of the interesting things, the British Tornadoes have a very good capability of cratering runways to prevent Iraqi aircraft from getting off. By that, they have a series of bombs that open up into bomblets that put holes in the runway. Some of the bomblets are timed devices so that repair teams, when they go out to repair the runways, they are always in danger of one of these delayed bombs going off. And I would suspect that the British would have that as part of their mission tonight.
Is there going to be any difficulty for the French, do you think, because the Iraqis fly and are very familiar with Mirage, the French aircraft?
Well, I suppose there's always a certain potential. The Iraqis are also aware of most of the characteristics of our aircraft, and I suspect that the Mirages and the various black boxes that are in the Mirages are characteristics that were not given to the Iraqis.
And Tony Cordesman, just while we're on this question of high tech tonight, let me ask you one question about the Tomahawk cruise missile, which would have been launched from battleships in the Persian Gulf. How does that evade radar?
It doesn't really have to evade it in detail because it is such a small system that it's very hard to detect. Further, it flies very low. It flies under radars. And as a result, it is able to penetrate very effectively. The other problem is the Iraqis really don't have much that can shoot it down. It can be programmed to avoid the major surface-to-air missile systems, and their fighters really don't have the kind of sophisticated radar, except for a very few MiG-29s, that could locate it and kill it from the air.
Okay, thank you very much to both of you for the moment. Just a reminder, in case you have joined us, that what American, and now we know British and French aircraft, are trying to do, and perhaps unmanned cruise missiles being used as well, are trying to suppress the Iraqi Air Force on the ground, trying to knock out their communications, their military communications, and as best we can tell, their civilian telecommunications by perhaps hitting the power grid in Baghdad, because we've not been able to reestablish contact with ABC's Gary Shepherd, who's in a hotel in downtown Baghdad. And of course, they also want to knock out rail lines and highways. The whole aim, if we can take a very quick look at a map of the area, is to try to encircle and cut off those Iraqi forces, including some of the finest Iraqi forces, in Kuwait. Cut them off from their supply lines, cut them off from the military command centers, cut them off from Saddam Hussein and the military high command, who are somewhere in Baghdad or elsewhere in Iraq tonight, trying to run this battle with which they have only, as General Traynor and Tony Cordesman said to us earlier, technical familiarity. During the war with Iran and Iraq, I think it was General Traynor who pointed out when he was there, he found that all of the Iraqi military were subscribing to every single military journal that was available in the Western world, but of course they've had no experience whatsoever with the overwhelming firepower of the American and now the British and the French aircraft. Jack McCarthy at the State Department.
Peter, just a moment ago we showed the black and white bombsight footage from Libya. It's interesting to note that when Secretary Baker was over in Saudi Arabia, the man who shot that footage was there with the F-111 pilots. He is going to be on a raid tonight without any question. Secondly, Secretary Baker is here in the State Department tonight. He is watching the reports as things unroll. The man who is very much responsible for putting the coalition together and making it work in these final days so that when this finally happened, the different countries would come together without a problem. At the front door of the State Department tonight, security is much tighter than it has been normally. People are coming in with cots and sleeping bags, anticipating it's going to be a long, long haul.
John, you at the State Department must be as mindful as anybody how severely diplomacy failed.
Diplomacy failed on the one hand, Peter, to bring about peace. I'm sure that Secretary Baker would argue that diplomacy was successful in bringing about a coalition to try and reverse what Saddam Hussein had done. First, peacefully, if he could, Baker would argue, or by force, which is, of course, happening tonight. But you are absolutely right. Diplomacy failed to bring about a peaceful settlement.
We'll be back, John. Thanks very much. John McCarthy at the State Department, the British House of Commons, and the French National Assembly today. It now all seems so coincidental, doesn't it? Voted overwhelmingly for the use of force. President Mitterrand, the French president, went on television and spoke to the nation, I think, for the first time in about 5 years. And explained to the French people how, in his view, diplomacy, despite all their efforts, had tried. They'd been one of the last to try with the Iraqis. And now is the time, he and the French premier said, alas, was the time to use force. The British Foreign Secretary, Douglas Hurd, has what may be the quote of the day from many people. The Iraqis, he said, have, for the time being, taken leave of their senses. Now, we finally found that comment from the former Majority Leader in the Senate, Robert Byrd, as he was arriving on Capitol Hill after hearing what the President had to say about the beginning of this war in the Gulf.
Yes, the President called me at 6 o'clock and said within the hour, by 7 o'clock, we would attack. And I said, well, Mr. President, my Bible tells me that our Heavenly Father, who hears us in secret, will reward us openly. I'm praying for you every night.
The former Majority Leader in the Senate, Robert Byrd, and in speaking of prayers for the President, you may recall that yesterday the President talked, among other people, to the Chaplain of the Senate, who said a prayer for him on the television. We have no real sense at the moment of the president's state of mind. Within the last couple of hours, anyway, over the last 24 hours, he has been described as a man at peace with his decision, a man who slept very well. That seems to be pretty much the attitude put forward by most of the leaders of the anti-Iraq coalition, who feel, to use the president's words, that they have gone more than the extra mile in trying to bring Saddam Hussein to a political settlement without using force in the first instance. We'll talk perhaps at great length, in fact undoubtedly we'll talk at great length in the days ahead, as to Saddam Hussein's mindset, but suffice it to say that perhaps all along those people who believed Saddam Hussein could be brought to a position where he would give up Kuwait without any combat whatsoever may never have intended that all along. This astonishingly proud man who someone observed earlier today has been turned, I think someone said perhaps very precisely, from a megalomaniac into the martyr, now has engaged in combat with what he has widely characterized as the imperialist forces of the West. He has a tremendous level of support in the Arab world, certainly, and elsewhere in the developing world, so we will take some time, perhaps, to get some clue to his thinking, but he will not, I suspect, be slow in coming forth with a message. The Secretary General of the United Nations has made a comment about half an hour ago. He, again, who tried so hard in the final days before the UN deadline, this was a UN deadline, remember, for the Iraqis to leave Kuwait, says this evening, "I am not well informed. I have no details of what happened, but I think it is for me to express my deep sorrow. I can only be saddened by the beginning of hostilities." As to the president's state of mind, back to the White House in Britain.
Well, Peter, a little bit more of the same kinds of descriptions we've had in recent days. The president is described here this evening as being calm and matter-of-fact as he received the early reports of this operation, sitting there with his jacket off, in jacket and tie, and having remarked, and I gave you a little of this earlier, when 7 o'clock rolled around, that was the time, exactly at 7 o'clock in the east, when the shelling by American forces was supposed to start. And there's some official wonderment here about the things that Gary Shepard was seeing and hearing just before that. But sounds that the president heard on, and reports that he got at 7 o'clock prompted him to turn to those with him and say that it started. It's just the way it was scheduled. We will not see the president tonight after this address, this 10 to 12 minute address that that he makes. And that, Peter, for the moment, I think, is, oh yes, there were a couple of questions asked about why this attack on Baghdad, with so many people there and the possibility of so much loss of life. And the answer to that from spokesman Fitzwater was, quote, "We believe that freeing Kuwait means attacking Iraqi forces and communications facilities, so we had to attack Baghdad." The question was also asked whether any consideration had been given to delaying this attack to allow some of the journalists about whom the president expressed concern to get out of Baghdad and indeed out of Iraq. And the answer was no, and Fitzwater hastened to point out that in his conversations with some news executives today, he said he had also suggested that they try other means of leaving than the tiny handful of flights that were still leaving there as of today. So that's it for the moment, Peter. I'm sorry to give it to you in bits and pieces, but that's the way it's coming.
Exactly, and that's the way it's going to be for, I suspect, the next several days at the very least, Fred. As to getting out of Baghdad at the moment, we cannot tell you how difficult it's going to prove to be for those journalists who may wish to leave. There were indeed a number of private charters which were intending to fly from the Jordanian capital, Amman, tomorrow morning in quite early to Baghdad to pick up those journalists and anybody else who wanted to leave. Other than Iraqis, by the way, who were not allowed to leave. In fact, Iraq earlier today closed its border with Turkey. A number of Iraqis had been trying to get north to Turkey and out of the border. That, by the way, is a particularly sensitive border because the Turks have been on the alert since the very beginning, lest the Iraqis try to attack up there to divert forces in the Persian Gulf. And the border between Iraq and Jordan is also closed for all those who do not prove to the satisfaction of the Jordanians that they have the means to get beyond Jordan. You remember very early in this crisis the enormous burden imposed on Jordan by the massive number of refugees who fled Kuwait and Iraq when the American buildup first began in the Gulf. Now that may change in Jordan if people can get out, but it's a long drive from Baghdad certainly to the Jordanian border or to the Turkish border. so people in Baghdad tonight, though we do not know them to be in any specific danger. We'll talk about that in a moment when we come back, but they have no way at the moment of getting up. 4:17 in the morning in Baghdad, 8:17 Eastern Time in the United States. The president will speak to the nation in about 45 minutes. We will be back in just a moment after this and a word from your local stations.
Unfortunately, the Wagner's new vacuum cleaner was not the most trouble-free in its class.
Bye-bye.
Neither was the new refrigerator, nor the new lawnmower they got such a good deal on. Thank goodness they made one new purchase that was the most trouble-free in its class, 2 years running, the Toyota Corolla.
Maybe you ought to just let that lawn die out.
I know what you do for me, Toyota.
It's Red Lobster's 19 shrimp and steak special. Sizzling scampi, fried shrimp, plus a juicy steak. 19 shrimp and steak, just $9.99. Hurry to Red Lobster.
I'll put you next to Ted.
Now, when life turns up the heat, there's Degree antiperspirant. Every time your body heat rises, Degree turns on extra protection. Degree, your body heat turns it on.
Don't you wish you'd bought the video cassette of Lady and the Tramp when you had the chance? Now it's gone, and time is running out to add Cinderella to your collection. But you still have a chance to own two of Disney's most delightful animated classics, The Magical Peter Pan and the Academy Award-winning The Little Mermaid. Still available, but only for a limited time. Don't let Peter Pan and The Little Mermaid get away.
Introducing Glade Plug-Ins Air Freshener. It keeps
on freshening and freshening
and freshening.
Plug it in, plug it in.
New Glade Plug-Ins freshens for 30 days.
Plug it in, plug it in.
Gently, constantly warms this refill cartridge for a full 30 days.
Freshens 30 days, freshens out of your way. Plug it in, plug it in.
After 30 days, just pop in a refill. Try Glade Plug-Ins and plug into 30-day freshness.
Plug it in.
Right now, we're all concerned with the outbreak of war in the Gulf. Monitoring the world 24 hours a day. Stay with the experience of ABC News.
This is an Action News special report. War with Iraq.
Hello, I'm Jim Gardner. As we watch the network to get information on the early stages of the Gulf War, I wanted to take this opportunity to tell you what Action News is trying to accomplish at this hour. We can now tell you that Action News reporter Dan Cuella is scheduled to depart at 1 o'clock in the morning from Andrews Air Force Base on a special Pentagon plane that will take him to Saudi Arabia, where he will do what he can to cover the conflict for us and other ABC stations. What happens to Dan after he gets to Saudi Arabia, frankly, we don't know, and Dan does not know either, but he will leave Andrews Air Force Base at 1 in the morning. Nora Mushanik is stationed at McGuire Air Force Base. We have Lauren Wilson at Dover Air Force Base, and we are trying to make contact with Greg and Stevie Schiff, a brother and sister from Wilmington who are in Jerusalem right now, attending the Hebrew University. We're trying to contact them by phone. At this point, there is no indication that Israel is under attack. That is our situation. Now let's go back to the network.
ABC News coverage of the Gulf War continues. Once again, reporting from New York, Peter Jennings.
It is about an hour and 20 minutes since we first learned from ABC's Gary Shepherd in Baghdad that the United States, in the first instance, then the British, and then the French, had begun an attack on occupied Kuwait and on various targets inside Iraq. What was known for so long as Operation Desert Shield, in the words of President Bush, is now Operation Desert Storm. It has been particularly difficult. It is bound to be particularly difficult for us to bring you information in a hurry from the Persian Gulf. We have lost power very briefly in eastern Saudi Arabia, where ABC's Bill Redeker was standing by there, and in central Saudi Arabia in Riyadh, which is the Saudi capital. Reporters and civilians have in some cases been sent to bomb shelters when air raid sirens went off. Nobody we know of, or nobody to the best of our knowledge, in either of those locations, in eastern or central Saudi Arabia, is in any immediate, should I say, nobody's been hurt. There's been no Iraqi retaliation. There has been no Iraqi response other than against American, British, and French aircraft in the night sky that we know of. But because the overwhelming concern of so many people at home and in the region is of chemical warfare, people are tonight putting on their gas masks, putting on their chemical suits, and trying to work under circumstances which they have either trained for or imagined for a very long period of time, but which, when they occur, are nerve-wracking and, in some cases, terrifying. Bill Redeker has, in fact, just shown up in eastern Saudi Arabia. Bill, tell us what you have been doing since we last saw you and what you know about the situation.
Well, the power was cut here, as you recall, when we were last on, and everybody was ordered by the military into the basement of the hotel that we're all stationed at as a part of an air raid drill. Nothing happened. There was no incoming fire, no missiles. Nobody was in any danger that we could tell. I believe it was precautionary. We then all came back up again and resumed our positions here. Another series of sirens has just started again. I don't know what that signals at this point, but they're in the background. Just a few minutes ago, Peter, we saw yet more aircraft taking off and headed out of here, more fighter jet aircraft, four of them, as a matter of fact. There were tiny lights that you may be able to notice as we show you this, heading out over the skyline here in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia. The first pool report from the Air Force media pool is in, and it says that the pool was awakened at about 1 a.m. by the near continuous thunder of the fighter bombers taking off. When the pool arrived at the flight line shortly thereafter, the parking aprons that had been crowded only Wednesday night were half empty. The first wave took off during the early morning hours. Air crews walked in pairs across the concrete to their waiting planes. One Air Force, we've lost power again.
Yeah, we have no way of predicting or even anticipating or even explaining why that is happening. Except to tell you in part that when the war began in the Persian Gulf itself, there are a number of American military analysts we've spoken to over the last several weeks who believe that one of the intentions will be is to black out the whole place electronically to all but those military personnel, both in the air and on the ground, who have absolute need to communicate with one another. And of course, over Kuwait and Iraq, one of the imperative desires of the military in the very first instance is to block out all Iraqi communications. So when that happens, it does not necessarily mean that something suddenly disastrous has happened. We've just lost power in many cases. And I have someone talking in my ear, so I apologize. I lose a train of thought there. Let's go to the State Department and ABC's John McCarthy.
Peter, as we are watching here this evening, the State Department has very little to report at this point. Obviously, Secretary Baker is upstairs trying to pay attention to what is going on, but the State Department is out of the loop in terms of the information. One of the things that the military planners said that they were looking at was the situation with the moon. It was a new moon on the 15th of January. And military planners were looking at how many days after that they would begin to get too much light for the kind of night operations that the U.S. was anticipating trying to conduct. So that may have been one of the key decision points. It's only 2 days past that new moon. So the military was perhaps looking at that as one of the reasons for why they wanted to go as soon or after the January 15th deadline as they have.
John, while I have you, because you were a military affairs correspondent for so many years, does a full moon work to anybody's advantage in terms of offense? I know it works to the Iraqi advantage in terms of defense because you can see better, but what about on offense?
No, not at all, Peter. The way the American military, with its high technology, has been trained to fight is to fight in the most dark conditions that they can get. When there is a full moon, it definitely plays into the Iraqis' hands and makes it an optimum situation for them to defend themselves because they can see their targets in the middle of the night. The American forces, either the ground forces or the air forces, prefer as dark a condition as they can have because they have all the night vision capability.
Okay, Jack McCarthy at the State Department, sometimes Jack, sometimes John, your nickname is Jack. One of the enormous concerns in the Middle East, and it has been a heightened concern over the last several days as to whether or not when war begins, the Iraqis might try to fracture the international, but particularly the Arab coalition, by trying to somehow draw in the Israelis. We want to go again to ABC's Dean Reynolds in Tel Aviv. Dean, you have said, and the Israeli military command has been fairly relaxed over the last couple of days about the intervention of Iraq. But is there any sign whatsoever, because we're getting nothing anywhere else, about an Iraqi movement in any way, shape, or form as to what they might have been doing?
No, Peter. Actually, let me be clear. We're in Jerusalem this evening.
I was told Tel Aviv.
The conclusion is slowly dawning on Israeli military officials here. I think it's based on informed speculation, but perhaps a little bit more. And it helps to explain what I would describe as a relaxed atmosphere around the country today. And it is their assessment that the H-2 and H-3 missile sites in western Iraq perhaps have been hit by the American Air Force and disabled. That accounts for no air raid sirens, or would account for no air raid sirens going off in this part of the world. The Israelis, of course, were acutely concerned about those missiles that threatened them, and the fact that Saddam had said that Tel Aviv would be the number one target. The feeling is within the military, although they cannot confirm this, that those sites perhaps have been disabled, and perhaps were disabled well in advance of the word that we were getting from Baghdad that an attack was underway.
Dean, I apologize we interrupt. We want to go straight away to Bill Redeker in Saudi Arabia. Bill.
Peter, the sirens have been going off again, and we have a report from the Marines. They claim that a Scud missile alert has been launched. That is the only detail we have at this time. We have no further information about where, what direction, and what is threatened. But we have had these sirens going off and these alerts a couple of times tonight. This is the action inside the hotel tonight. There have been a couple of these air warnings where people have headed down to the shelter in the basement of the hotel and put on gas masks, even though there have been no gas alerts, I should stress at this point. We are a considerable distance from Iraq, but still within that missile range.
You're about 400 miles from the southernmost point of Iraq and about 330 some odd miles from Kuwait, right?
I think that's about correct, yeah.
And is there a real anticipation there that you and others might be on the Iraqi target list?
It's always a possibility, sure. We are within range, and we are near an area that that could be on that target list, yeah.
Tell us something about, do you want to leave right now?
No, we've not heard anything, and there are a fair number of us still out here, so now there go the sirens again.
I don't mean to keep asking you this question. I assume that when you want to leave, Bill, you're just going to up and leave and interrupt whatever we're doing at the moment. I'll just keep talking to you until you want to leave. What I'd like to know is about the missile defense system and the level of confidence that the military has about protecting you, obviously, and the other civilians, because you're quite close to a major civilian center there in Dahran, but also the military airfields behind you.
There are Patriot missile systems ringing this area, and that is, of course, the premier air defense system put up by the Army. It was used in Europe by the NATO forces. It's never been used in combat. It's not combat tested, but there have been several test firings of it. It's proved to be extremely accurate. This is what we were told by the Army. So there are Patriot missile systems which are designed to knock down incoming missiles or aircraft.
Now, you are fairly close. I think everybody knows it is common knowledge that you're in eastern Saudi Arabia and fairly close to a couple of well-populated areas. What are people most worried about in your region? I hesitate here because I'm a little cautious about whether or not, lest we never violate security and the guidelines that the military have set down for us. But tell me as much as you can about the civilian population that is near you and its attitude today.
Well, there's a large oil community, a community of expatriate Americans in particular, and British, who reside here that work in the oil industry. So there's always been a level of concern by those workers, though they've been here for many years. But they're obviously concerned. There's been a fair amount of ticket buying over the last few days for flights out of eastern Saudi Arabia. There are three suburb areas that have grown up around the oil industry here. And of course, we're on the coast as well, and near a major air facility. So it's a fairly good commercial center in the eastern part of the country.
Anything else you want to add at the moment?
Not at this point. We're just trying to figure out, I assume, as everybody else is, what the level of threat may be. And it's completely unclear at this time, only that we have that earlier report that the Marines claim that a Scud missile attack has been launched. Again, no further details on that. And, of course, we have heard those air warnings in the past 15 minutes or so.
Okay, but you go and find out, and we'll come back to you when it is most convenient to you. We want to go to London now and talk to Henry Dodds, who is a senior editor. Correct me, Mr. Dodds, if I'm right or wrong, with Jane's Defense Weekly. Am I correct?
Nearly right. It's Jane's Intelligence Review.
Jane's Intelligence Review,
enough.
But it's all part of the same world-renowned organization that pays attention to military hardware. Tell us about the Scud missile, how far it can go, what kind of a danger it poses, and whether, in your view, given the fact that it's never been tested in battle, the American Patriot missile can defend against it.
Well, the basic Scud missile doesn't have the range to reach Dhahran. So if the Iraqis have fired a missile, they would have to have fired one of their own modifications of the Scud. And even that would be at the extreme range of that missile. What that means is that the missile isn't going to be carrying a full warhead. So even if it does strike a target, it's not going to have the most devastating effect of a normal Scud fired at shorter range.
Isn't the complication here, Mr. Dodd, that we tend to talk about missiles in terms of explosive capacity, but now we're talking about missiles which also have a chemical or bacteriological capability?
I mean, the key question as far as any missile firing is concerned is, what is the warhead going to be when that missile lands on its target? The chances are that the Iraqis are going to be firing high explosive warheads in the first instance, but you can't rule out the possibility of having a chemical warhead with either mustard or with nerve agent, and that's quite a different matter.
Okay, we're going to go and take a look at our map now and go on talking about the Scud and any other long-range missile. I think we need to get a little closer on the map if possible. Mr. Dodd, talk a little bit more about the Iraqi capacity to respond or initiate long-term missile attacks. Who might they hit and with what? Stop right there, Matt, please.
Okay, if we look at the basic Scud, the Iraqis have large numbers of these from the Soviet Union. Indications are that they may have up to 500 missiles, but only about 36 launchers. And I'll come back to the point of launchers in a moment. But the basic Scud only has a range of about 150 miles. So during the War of the Cities against Iran, the Iraqis modified some of their Scuds to give them a longer range.
You can see up in the upper corner of your television screen, if the cameraman will stop right there, the War of the Cities was between Baghdad and Tehran, which has just gone out of your picture on the upper right-hand side of the television screen. But that will give you some indication of the distance from Baghdad to Tehran is what, 300 or 400 miles, Mr. Don?
I believe it's about 300 miles.
All right, so looking back down on the map now, if you were firing Scuds from the western border of Iraq, you could certainly reach Riyadh or not?
No, you couldn't reach Riyadh with a conventional Scud. You would have to have one of the modified Scuds. And the way the Iraqis have produced missiles with a longer range is to extend the missile, but also to put a much smaller warhead on it. So although they get the greater range, they don't have the benefit of having the full-size warhead on the missile when it reaches a target.
Now, as you... Sorry, my apologies. Go ahead.
The other point is that at the longer ranges, the missiles are relatively inaccurate. They can't be guaranteed to land on a target more than a mile either side.
Okay. Can you just briefly comment, before we go away from you for just a minute, the other weapons systems that, unless they've all been eliminated by the U.S., British, and French Air Force at the moment, that the Iraqis might be trying to get into action?
Apart from the missiles, the Iraqis will be looking to get their air force off the ground at first light. But we know that this morning there was heavy fog in the area, and that may actually delay the Iraqi air force from getting off the ground in the first place. But the next couple of hours are going to be critical.
Okay, the Iraqi, of course, has a reasonably sophisticated air force, if my memory serves me, and I'm working from memory at the moment. In fact, let me do better than that. Let me bring in Tony Cordesman, one of our two military analysts. Tony, as I recall, the Iraqis have about 500 combat aircraft. The most sophisticated is the MiG 29 and the MiG-25, but they have Soviet and French aircraft, right?
That's right, Peter, but they only have about 730 combat aircraft. Oh. Out of those, probably somewhere between 500 and 600 are operational. The most sophisticated ones they have are the Mirages. They have a little over 100 of those. Some may not be operational. They have one squadron of MiG-29s. That's one of the latest Soviet air defense aircraft. And a squadron of Su-24s. That's the most lethal aircraft they have.
The Su-24 is the Sukhoi bomber, am I right?
Well, that's a fighter bomber. Actually, it has more payload capability than their old obsolescent so-called medium bombers, which are now way out of date.
Now, we are, I wish to reinforce, not getting much information about how well the U.S. primarily and subsequently the British and French air forces are doing this evening. So we do not have any idea whether or not the Iraqi Air Force has been able to get into the air in any way, shape, or form. But General Bernard Traynor up in Boston, who was our other resident tonight, military analyst, based on your experience with the Iraqis, you think they would have got something up in the air?
I doubt it. I doubt it at this point. I think the raid probably came as a complete surprise to them.
Why do you think so?
Well, I think the indications are that from your reporter in Baghdad, that at least the initial raids went in there very quickly. Now, it takes a little time, unless somebody's on runway alert, to get organized, to get off the ground. And I suspect that there were a lot of deception plans involved in preparation for this attack, and communications jamming. I suspect that they had a tough time getting off, and clearly the airfields and their air power would be one of the principal targets for the air raids. And I suspect even if some of the aircraft did manage to get on down the runway, I suspect they didn't last very long.
No offense to you, General Traynor, or anybody else for that matter, but there's a certain antiseptic quality to this discussion. I guess it's bound to be that way because we're talking about the potential of military hardware to perform this evening. But give us a little broader view along the same level of, because you know the Iraqi military, what they may be experiencing as human beings both in the air and on the ground at the moment.
Well, I suspect the Iraqi officers that fly those airplanes and those that control the various systems are reasonably well aware of the U.S. capability, and that any attack that would come against them would be a surprise attack for maximum effect. For the most part, they've been keeping their radar systems down so as not to send out their signature, as it were, so that we would know the various frequencies they are operating on, probably also to conduct maintenance on the equipment and also to save the equipment, because I know that they don't have much in the way of spare parts. So if this operation was planned with a certain amount of deception involved in it and then a massive across-the-board attack at all points, this put the Iraqis at a serious disadvantage, not only in terms militarily, but also psychologically. Now, I certainly would agree that there's always the case of the individual getting off or the Scud being fired, but those are going to be, in a sense, the exceptions. And for the most part, I would suspect that the intensity of this raid, which I assume is probably at this point up in the at about 1,000 aircraft at least, with some of them already back from the initial strikes, was planned very meticulously, and with the exception of the usual friction that comes with a normal military operation, was probably reasonably successful.
Okay, thanks, General Traynor. Eerie almost in many respects, because we've heard no report of any Iraqi counterattack whatsoever. The only indication we've had is that report from Bill Redeker in eastern Saudi Arabia, who says that the Marines have reported to him that a Scud missile has been launched, at least a Scud missile. We have no idea where it may be going, but you heard from Henry Dodds at Jane's in London there, where it is not possible for it to go. In terms of Baghdad itself, though, we have lost contact with Gary Shepherd directly in his hotel on the outskirts of Baghdad. We do get a sort of sketchy reporting that what's been going on almost since Gary Shepherd first saw those aircraft and the anti-aircraft coming in is a brief anti-aircraft battle, and then a lull, and then another anti-aircraft battle again. So unless the Iraqis on the ground on the western outskirts of Baghdad are simply responding to their own nervousness or the nervousness of adjacent anti-aircraft batteries, there would appear to be, and this is highly speculative, there would appear to be a repeat of the attack on the command and control centers on the western edge of Baghdad and the military airfield there, and of course the missile sites. The only sense, ironically, that is other than us talking that we have a battle tonight is Gary Shepherd in the Al Rashid Hotel in Baghdad about an hour and 45 minutes ago. It does seem longer in some respects, but here's a brief excerpt from that very first report. We were talking to him, and suddenly it began to happen.
Peter, I am looking directly west from our hotel now, and throughout the entire sky there are flashes of light. It appears to be some sort of anti-aircraft fire, a couple of flashes on the horizon now. Something is definitely underway here. Something is going on. The whole sky lit up with these flashes continually.
Is it far in the distance, Gary?
Occurring. And now we can see an obvious tracers in the sky, planes now coming toward this hotel, and flashes, the sound of flak and flares. Obviously, an attack is underway of some sort. It appears that there is tracer fire coming up from the ground.
We've always known all along that the primary Iraqi strength was going to be on the ground. As I said a moment ago, that is the only indication we truly have of fighting on a first-hand basis. Now, President Bush is going to talk to the nation in about 20 minutes from now, precisely. And after that, General Colin Powell, who is the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and the Secretary of Defense, Dick Cheney, are going to brief at the Pentagon, which will be our first full assessment of how the military campaign has gone tonight in Operation Desert Storm, as the president has called it. We can go back to Jerusalem now, to ABC's Dean Reynolds, because the Israeli intelligence, has already, Dean, I understand, made an assessment of at least some of the targets that have been hit.
That's right, Peter. It's the targets in western Iraq, the missile sites that threatened Israel with the Scud missiles. The assessment, which I would really call more a deductive analysis by the Israeli military, is that those missile sites have been destabilized at the very least, perhaps even taken out during this wave of an attack by the American Air Force. Prime Minister Shamir hasn't even felt the need to go into the office. He's monitoring events at home. There has not been a state of emergency declared here. There are no air raid sirens. People have been told to stay at home, to open their gas masks, because even one missile is considered a perilous threat to the country. But for the most part, it is relaxed, it is quiet, and it is calm.
What time is it?
You asked earlier. It is now 3:45 in the morning here in Jerusalem. You asked me earlier about what other Arab radio stations may have been reporting of the events of this morning. Damascus Radio, we are told, is reporting it matter-of-factly. Syria, of course, is part of the American coalition against Iraq. They are also playing some classical music, but they are not taking any particular slant one way or the other. Amman Radio, at least a while ago, was broadcasting anti-American propaganda, is what our monitor described it as, and playing nationalistic music. Riyadh Radio, which Barry Dunsmore could probably fill you in on better than I, but at least it was described a few minutes ago as broadcasting anti-Saddam commentary. Now, the Central Command of the Israeli army has been meeting this morning to decide what to do with the Palestinians in the occupied territories. The Palestinians, of course, big supporters of Saddam Hussein. So far, there is no report of any demonstration or any clash in the occupied territories this morning, but we have heard that curfews are in place over much of the area. In an abundance of caution, perhaps even some word that tanks may be brought in to keep things under wraps, to make sure that the Israeli army at this moment is not distracted by any intifada activity.
Okay, Dean Reynolds in Jerusalem, thank you very much. It has indeed been an enormous concern as to what an American attack might mean throughout the Arab world. It is certainly, among other things, not true to say that all Palestinians are open or at least overt supporters of Saddam Hussein. You may recall that in the last several days, two of Yasser Arafat's most senior aides were murdered in Tunis, in the constant inter-Palestinian or intra-Palestinian violence that goes on for years and years. And one of those men who was murdered Abu Iyad, a very close confidant of Yasser Arafat, was one person who thought it was a mistake for Yasser Arafat to tie his star so closely to that of Saddam Hussein, who had come to the conclusion that there was going to be a tremendously negative repercussion for Palestinians as a result of being so intimately associated with Saddam Hussein. But the reason that so many in the Arab world do associate with Saddam Hussein has to do with, among other things, a frustration at the very thing Dean Reynolds was talking about, the inability of the world or the Palestinians or the Israelis to come to any kind of reconciliation at all. And Saddam Hussein in the days just before the war, of course, tried repeatedly to tie his invasion of Kuwait to some kind of progress for the Palestinians in international conference. President Bush and the other members of the international coalition balked. The president was absolutely determined. The French and the Soviets were a little more interested in convening an international conference, which of course is now that war has begun a moot point. The Soviet news agency TASS reported tonight that hostilities had begun but had no other comment. ABC's Middle East analyst Judith Kepper is back from the region. Judith, perhaps an opening comment from you this evening on how you think that the beginnings of a military campaign are going to play out in terms of Arab emotions.
Well, this morning when I left Amman, there was an overwhelming sense of sadness in the city. And when we went to the airport to get on the charter, it was interesting, three Iraqi 727s were sitting on the ground. Presumably those were the charters to take people out of Baghdad. And the feeling at the airport, a lot of military, very kind, smiling, people were very pleasant to us, but a great sense of sadness and of real impending doom over the area.
Now, Judith, you were in the occupied West Bank and the Gaza Strip on this trip to the Middle East as well. If, as it appears evident, Saddam Hussein is now not able, that's a little too presumptuous of me, I grant, to mount a serious offensive attack against Israelis and liberate the Palestinians, as he had promised, the Palestinians will have an enormous letdown, won't they?
I think the Palestinians already feel a letdown, particularly those in the territories. They feel forgotten and betrayed. There have been people being killed and injured on a daily basis. Jerusalem is once again a divided city between Israelis and Palestinians because of the issue of personal security. People on both sides are getting stabbed. So this is a real loss for the Palestinians, and those in the occupied territories feel it the most. The economic pressure is enormous, the political dismay, the confusion, and the feeling of really having been abandoned by everybody.
But you do remind us, thank you, Judith Kipper, not quite 2 hours after we first learned of the U.S. attack on Kuwait and Iraq, that the long-term ramifications of this war for the United States and for everybody in the region are enormous. We're also joined this evening by the former director of the CIA, William Colby. My question to you, Mr. Colby, is in somewhat the same vein. After 5.5 months of negotiations, are you still surprised to see the United States go to war against Iraq so quickly after the deadline expired?
No, I think the president set a deadline and intended to follow it. And he set it with the idea of having it happen fairly soon after that.
As you watched,
I was surprised to have it been the same day, but maybe another day or so, that was about right.
As you have seen this events unfold this evening, and they're hardly really unfolding in any full way for us, what are your early thoughts?
Well, I think the president has handled this very well with a massive first strike, which it appears to be. And with the first objective to clear out the Saudi Air Force, the Iraqi Air Force, so that he'll be free to go do whatever else with the air that we want to do.
Before the war began, there was a good deal of talk about the capacity of the Iraqi military. And I am a little haunted often by the former commander of the Pakistani Armored Brigade. In fact, at one point, the commander of the Pakistan Army, who said to me that when this war begins, you and the United States are going to be very embarrassed about how you overestimated the capacity of the Iraqis. Do you have any sense at this stage that the United States has overestimated or underestimated the Iraqi capabilities?
I don't think we'd have about 400,000 troops there if we had underestimated them. We obviously have a very high opinion of their potential. Now, whether they perform that way is another question, but using the lessons of Vietnam, the military decided that if follow the basic rule that if you're going to use military force, use a lot of it quickly. That is the way you use it.
Okay, Mr. Colby, thank you very much for joining us. Tony Cordesman, our one of our two resident military analysts for this Operation Desert Storm. You have been in the last several days quite insistent that the Iraqis are not well prepared. So when the briefing occurs from, I'm going to put you on the spot a little here, with the former, with the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and the Defense Secretary in about an hour from now or less, what do you think they're going to say?
Well, I think they'll say that they've achieved a great deal of initial success with the air operation. I think, as General Traynor pointed out earlier, the Iraqis will not have had a particularly effective response, particularly with their surface-to-air missiles, which are their major system of defense at night. I don't know whether they're going to brief us on the ground, but I think when they do get down to the detail there, they're going to also make it clear that many of the Iraqi forces are not properly in place and that they don't really have that marvelous defensive line that some people have said they do.
But in your view, it would be a serious mistake now, after a couple of hours of us talking, for Americans to overestimate what has been accomplished this evening.
I think we have to understand that even if we flew several hundred sorties, even 1,000 sorties, we have days to go before we have decisively defeated or incapacitated just the air and missile component and the weapons of mass destruction and command centers in Iraq and Kuwait.
So in I apologize.
We have not even begun the land battle, which, if we have to fight it, is the one which poses the most serious risks for American and coalition forces.
I actually wanted to stop you short of the land battle there and sort of stay on the air battle for a second, because